There is another one very important question. In the US exam, I hope I'm recollecting it properly, that if you fail 3 or 4 times, then you may have to wait longer period, maybe 1 year. Initially it is 3 months for each attempt, but after 3 to 4 attempts, then you will be allowed to take the exam after 1 year. Do you have any rules, such rules here? Like you have only maximum 3 attempts or 4 attempts?
That's it. Actually, we have a rule of maximum of 3 attempts for the AFK exam. So you have to clear the exam within the 3 attempts. Now, I do not know any candidate who has not been able to clear the exam in 3 attempts or less. It is the maximum that is given there, but eventually everyone clears within the 3 attempts. I don't really know. I don't really have any personal knowledge of what would happen if you're not able to clear it in 3 attempts, because I don't really know anyone out there, but probably you would have to reapply for the process. That's my understanding, but things might have changed on the NDEB side. So there are 3 attempts as a maximum for the exams.
Do you have, since it is a COVID situation, does your coaching institute provide online coaching for students, for international students?
Absolutely. So we were actually the first agency to actually start online tutorials. We have been doing this for quite some time now, and we were basically doing this even before COVID hit. So our tutorials were aimed at working professionals who were in India, the Middle East, Hong Kong, Singapore, and New Zealand, and also some parts of North America. And so I have students almost all across the world right now, who log in on the weekends to take up the exams, because take up the classes. It's because weekends are a commonality. Almost everyone's free during the weekends. So we take strictly online classes, and I've been doing this in an online format way before COVID.
And how much generally the fees for this coaching for one exam coaching?
So the fees are expensive if you think of the Indian perspective. Most of the classes here, and not just our class, most of the classes, they have a similar fee pattern. We charge roughly $3,850 with taxes additional. And this is for the entire 6-month program. It is for the materials that we provide. It is for the online live classes. And we also provide certain weekly tests or weekly exams for our students. So all of that included is, it's charged there.
So once in 6 months, you have to appear for one exam. And you said you may have to wait for 1 month for the result.
Results,
yes. A student has to prepare for 6 months. So 7 to 8 months for one exam.
Absolutely.
And you have 3 exams. We discussed about the first and second exam in depth. If the viewers have any question, they can always mention in the comment section, and we can ask Dr. Sagar for some more explanation. Let's talk about the third exam now, which many of the students have always told me is the most difficult exam to crack. Now, I know people may have, it is highly subjective. But the obvious question which I would like to know is that I am a practitioner in India. Do you think the exams would be easier, the third exam, since it's a practical one? Is it easier for the practitioners and difficult for the undergraduate students, because they may not have so much of clinical exposure?
That's a beautiful question. So the answer is, again, varied. It depends on what kind of practice have you been doing? What kind of works are you comfortable with? Are you comfortable with proper ideal rubber dam placement? Because all of these exams, they are done on mannequins. So they don't really test anything less than ideal. They want you to have ideal skills. So for example, when we prep a PFM crown, you might prep it with a buccal surface, that's a shoulder, lingual surface, that's a chamfer. And you might prep it with a buccal surface and lingual surface, that's a shoulder. You might prep chamfers on both surfaces just because you might want a metal margin, minimal metal margin throughout. Now, what is being asked for your exercise is important, because if the exercise asks PFM crown with a ceramic all around at the margins, you should not be prepping a chamfer anywhere. And if you prep a chamfer, it's considered a negative scoring. You basically fail there. You have to have the exact dimensions that are mentioned as ideal. Now, this is the trickiest part. Your hand skills might be amazing clinically, but when it comes to a mannequin, they look for ideality. And there, it is very, very subjective. Hand skills are very subjective, but there is a way of objectively checking that. And the NDEB has basically released the entire grading scheme. They have it very, very clearly, very transparently on the website. This is the grading scheme. This is what we look for. This is ideal. This is not ideal, but still okay. This is not acceptable. So say if you have a class 2, and in your class 2, the clearance from the adjacent teeth from your proximal wall should be 0.5 mm, 0.5 mm. If your clearance is 0.2 to 0.3 mm, you failed it. If your clearance is 0.3 to 0.5, you're still okay. It is not 100% ideal, but it's acceptable. If it is more than 0.5, you failed it. So they play in tolerances of 0.2 millimeters there. So if your if your prep margin, say your margin of your crown prep, it is supposed to be 0.8 mm for, say, zirconia. If it is 1 millimeter, you failed. If it is 0.6 millimeter, you failed. So this is the kind of the accuracy, micro accuracy that they go for. And for this exam, that's why you need additional training. Even if you are a practitioner with loads of experience clinically in all of this, you should have additional training so that you know how to do this ideally on a mannequin, because that is what they check for. They check for ideality, unfortunately, and that is what makes this a difficult exam. That is what makes it difficult to take up without proper training.
And how much time do you require for this exam, for preparation and coaching? Is it 6 months? And since it is a practical exam, I don't think, since it is practical exam, it is not possible online, or is it also possible online?
So there are some enterprising individuals who started the online coaching where they would basically tell you how to do the prep via video chat, and you do the prep, show it to them, you take some photographs on some apps, and it measures this. None of it gets close to what an instructor sitting in the chair right next to you will tell you in terms of feedback. Because one of the most important things that I've learned for this exam is the feedback that you get, the critical feedback that you get from the instructors. This is the reason why you're able to improve your work. And with this online situation, it is a bit difficult to do that, to provide feedback remotely. There, we have had to adapt because we don't have options other than making it online. But the best way to actually do this is hopefully once the lockdown lifts and we're able to resume in-person training, it would be in person. This exam is best taken in person. The training is best taken in person. You could try it on your own. You could try it, without training. And NDEB says that you don't need training for it. That is true. But the chances of you passing without proper qualified training are slim to none, especially when it comes to this exam. It's a very difficult step because you have to kind of work with that micro accuracy. For this reason, you definitely need magnification. You need your loops. I don't practice without my loops at all for any clinical purpose. And you might need higher magnification. Say, instead of 2x, you might have to step up to 6x just to kind of get the additional edge there. Hope that answers the question.
Yeah. And is the fees for this in-person coaching different than the part 1, part 2 exams?
Absolutely. The fees for those in-person coaching, it depends again on which agency you go through or which tutorial you go through. We don't have any courses running as of now just because of COVID, because we've kind of kept everything in person. We want to do that correctly. So we haven't had any luck reopening it for now. We hope that it reopens in the coming August, but we'll just see. The fees are roughly about $10,000. So $8,000 to $10,000 is the general fee scale for all of these coachings, and it is the same across the board, all across Canada in the various centers that you have, the training centers. The fee is generally $8,000 to $10,000 because it involves not only the training that the instructor provides, the critical feedback that the instructor provides. It will give you access to the center where there are mannequin setups, where there are chair setups, just like what you'd see in the NDEB. And you could just practice on those chairs for a given set of hours, say about 6 hours a day or 8 hours a day you have to practice, because it takes a lot of practice. Everyone can do a good all ceramic crown, but to do the perfect all ceramic crown, that takes practice. And that's the difference between pass and fail in the NDEB. Good versus perfect.
And how much time do you think 6 months is generally sufficient? For example, I have seen the students buying all these. Yeah, there is a very important question here, which I remembered here too. That there are students who have told me one thing is they buy these equipments and they practice in their home. And the second is you have to take the materials for the exam also. Is that right?
100% correct for both. So when I took up the bench course training, so this is not just for the first part or the third part of the exam, the ACS. Some schools, when you're applying to schools, they have their own bench tests, like University of Saskatchewan, Manitoba, and Western Ontario, all universities other than U of T have a bench test. So I took up, training for that. I wanted to prep myself for that specifically. So I bought all of the ancillary equipment. I bought typhos, phantom heads, I bought the jaws and the hand pieces, materials that are needed to do certain exercises like composite resin restorations, amalgam capsules. I bought temporary crown materials, polishing kits, all of it. So I was basically running a stocked dental chair. Other than the chair, I had everything with me. And you have to practice this for 6 months. The kits, you can make it on your own. You can actually buy kits that have been pre-made and are being sold. Some coaching institutes also have that option to, you can buy the entire kits from them. Now, you do have to practice whatever it is, whether you are practicing on your own or you're practicing in the center. You have to put in quite a bit of time. And at one given point of time, I was working full time, 9 to 5. And then in the evenings from about 6 o'clock to about 10:30 in the evening, I used to practice in the center, just repeatedly doing crown preps, class twos and restorations, just to kind of get the hang of doing things perfectly. And you have to do it for quite some time. So 6 months is actually more than enough to gain your hand skills to the level of being able to do a class two perfectly, to being able to do a crown perfectly with those dimensions. Now, if you want additional time, that's again a personal choice. Some people prep for the exam for almost a year before they take it up. But you can prep for it in 6 months. 6 months is more than adequate to do it.
And is the third exam also conducted once in 6 months, or since it's a practical exam, you have more attempts, more slots available?
So up to March 2021, there were two times in a year that the exams were conducted. It was a little restrictive. I think it was 2 to 3 times a year. Somewhere in the middle, it was 3 times a year as well. But now the big change that has come up with the NDEB's announcement in March 2021 was that the number of attempts, or the restriction on attempts that was there, 3 attempts for AFK, 3 attempts for ACG and ACS, they've been removed for ACS. So AFK, you still have 3 attempts that you can take. ACG, still 3 attempts. ACS, on the other hand, unlimited attempts. So you don't have to worry about the attempts there. If you fail, you can retake it. It was conducted twice or thrice a year. Now it would be offered just like the INDD is being offered, once every 2 weeks, once every 3 weeks, or once a week. They haven't released what the frequency will be, but it will definitely be throughout the year. So that's what they have mentioned. And the third biggest change that has come was, earlier these exams used to be conducted across the country at the various dental schools. So our school, U of T, was one of the centers. Western Ontario, University of Western Ontario was a center. Dalhousie was a center. You could basically pick a center and take up the exam there. you could do the practical exam there. Whichever school has a training setup there for its students would open up its classrooms for international dentists as well. That is out. All of the exams from now on, the ACS exams, will be conducted at a center in Ottawa that is being purpose-built for it. So the NDB just released this information March saying that they have, you know, started constructing a testing center where they will allow students from all across Canada, across the world to come and take up the ACS test. And it will only be done at that center, nowhere else. So you have to go to Ottawa in person to take up the exam starting 2022.
That's quite very important information. So 8,000 to 9,000 for the third exam coaching, 3,000 to 4,000 for one each exam in the initial two exams. How much is the exam overall, each exam or overall these three exams, the official examination charges apart from the coaching?
So let's go right from the start. So moment you start off with your licensing process, to send the documents, you have to create a profile. That, if I'm correct, it still costs the same amount that it used to, about $3,000. Then the exams themselves, they have become slightly more expensive. So another $3,000 to $4,000 each exam. So AFK and ACJ. ACJ might actually be a little less expensive, but please don't quote me on this because I haven't really seen those numbers, the new numbers that have come out on the NDEB website. ACS, at last count, it was $9,000 officially at the that you have to pay at the NDEB to register for the exams. So in my calculations, it would be about $18,000 in total that you will have to spend for the entire licensing process. And then don't forget, at the end of AFK, ACJ, ACS, you have to write OSCEs, which would be another $3,000 if the past has been any recollection. So it's kind of like $18,000 to $22,000 that you'd spend only for the licensing process exams. For the training, you might spend about $16,000 in total for the training. But you have to keep in mind, you might have to buy your kit, you might have to buy your handpiece, you might have to buy typhos and teeth. So for all of that, you might spend about $3,000 to $4,000. So say another total amount of $20,000 for your training itself, $22,000 for your exams. So that brings us to a rough total of about $42,000 for the licensing process. Give or take another, just to be safe, give or take another $8,000. So I'd say comfortably, you would be spending about $50,000 in your process of being licensed as a dentist from the start to the finish. It's a huge number. It is definitely a huge, huge number, but you get quite a bit of funding as such. It's all self-funded. You don't get funding from the government for it, but you get quite a bit of loans for that. So there are certain loans that are available only to newcomers in Canada. It's Windmill Microfinancing, if memory serves me correct. It used to be called Immigrant Access Fund, which would basically give you about $20,000 in loans unsecured just because you're a new immigrant to Canada and you're getting through your licensing process.
That is with PR.
With PR, 100% yes. All of this, information I'm giving you is for a candidate who has a PR, irrespective of whether you live in the country or not. If you have a PR, this is what you could apply for. Some of the banks in Canada, like RBC, Scotia Bank, TD Bank, these major banks, they also offer line of credits, basically open-ended loans for up to about $75,000 if you're a candidate in the licensing process. It basically works up from $20,000 to $50,000 to $75,000 based on your estimate. So you could basically take this entire, exam using those loans, and you could go for the process. Repayment, it would not be an issue once you're a dentist, that's for sure. But you could also do what I did. I basically worked throughout the process. So whatever I earned, it went to my living expenses and to this. So kind of, I had broken it down into three sections. Whatever I earned would go into partially living expenses, partially into the exam fund, partially into savings. So that's kind of, you could do it comfortably, but it is a lot more work if you're doing that, especially in Canada. If you're doing it from India, you can actually continue to work in your clinic. You can actually continue to earn through your clinical practice in India while you're doing the first two exams. And once you kind of had enough saved up, you can come to Canada, start with this licensing process just for the third exam, and you would spend a little less money in terms of loans. You basically will have to take less loans while you did that. That's the thing. And this brings me to the financial advantage that direct licensing has. In school, you might end up paying $150,000 minimum only for tuition. Then additional expenditures, living expenses, all of that comes into play. If you are in a direct licensing process, you might end up paying about $50,000 plus living expenditures. So you end up saving almost $100,000.
So thank you, Dr. Sagar, for so much of information regarding AFK exams. And I'm sure we have pretty much covered all the required obvious questions which a student has to think before giving this exam. I have few questions which our viewers have put in our earlier podcast, and I hope that you can answer it. The first question is by Dr. Priyanka, and she is asking she wants to know about dental specialty assessment program for MDS applications.
Okay, so for Dr. Priyanka's question, DTSAP is something like the one-year training program that the internationally trained specialists have to take. Now, this is considered kind of the licensing process for specialists. If you want to license yourself as a specialist in Canada and not as a general dentist, you have to go through this process. The process starts with, again, sending your documents over to the NDEB, getting a profile, and then registering for the dental core specialty knowledge exams, the DSCKE exam, which is basically like the AFK exam, but for specialists. So you would have questions from AFK as well as questions from statistics, loads of questions from statistics, loads of questions from your specialty subject as well. So it is kind of slightly tougher than the AFK exam, but it's completely doable. Now, once you get that, once you are done with it, you get a score again, just like your AFK exam. You take that score and you have to apply to schools. There is no second process of doing a licensing directly. You have to apply to a school. Each school has a DTSAP or the specialty assessment programs. It is like a abridged one-year program only for the specialist. So what you do is you join in the program for 1 year. You're put in with the grad students of that specialty in that school. And at the 1 year's end, what they generally do is they evaluate your proficiency across the board. Throughout the year, your proficiency is evaluated. And at the end of that 1 year, you are eligible to take up the licensing exams or the board exams for that specialty. So you have to take up the board exams for whichever specialty that you might be in. See the say if you are an endodontist, you might have to take up the board exam.
So you get a, like, you can directly practice as a specialty.
That is excellent. The advantage. Exactly. Yeah.
That so is you get the advantage of it.
Okay. You get licensed as a specialist, but let me just add in one small quick note here. Not all specialties from India are eligible to do this. Unfortunately, my specialty, conservative dentistry and endodontics, because it contains two specialties, restorative dentistry or conservative dentistry and endodontics, it is unfortunately ineligible for DSCKE exam route, because endodontics is a separate CODA accredited specialty. Restorative dentistry is another separate specialty. They don't mix it. So prosthodontists can apply, periodontists can apply, orthodontists can apply, oral pathologists can apply for this exam, oral surgeons. It is very, 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 very difficult to get accepted even after we apply, because most of the oral surgery specialties here are 6-year programs, not 3-year programs. So they don't accept your training. Endodontics and oral maxillofacial radiology and medicine, it's not eligible. Unfortunately, that's just the way it is.
If it is from India, where we have together. I think other countries where the endodontics is separate, they can still apply.
Okay. Exactly, Karan, like Iran.
Yes. Karan is asking, what is the minimum score needed for AFK exam to apply for universities?
So, beautiful question, Dr. Karan. Unfortunately, there is no correct answer because universities, they actually look at your profile and grade you based on your profile and your specialty training, if you have it, and also your score, and most importantly, the way that you perform in their exams, be it the bench test or the universities. A good competitive applicant as such would have a score in the high 90s, say 91 to 98 or 100. But I know people who have gotten into dental schools even with scores of 82, 81.
Okay. Himani is asking, I just want to know that after BDS, is it compulsory to have experience in the same field when applying for direct PR through express entry, or any experience that should come under NOC level like manager?
Great question. Dr. Himani, was that correct?
Yeah.
So Dr. Himani, what I can say for that answer is, yes, you need to have work experience of at least 1 year under NOC 3113, that is dentists or dental specialists. So that means after your BDS, if you worked as a manager or if you worked in clinical research, that experience does not count. Unfortunately, it does not count because your degree was in dentistry. Now, if you had an additional degree of business management and then you worked in management, yes, you would be considered as an MBA grad altogether and not a dentist. If you're a dentist, you should have work experience as a dentist for application of PR. But the best source for this is the Canadian government. So you have to check through their website to know for sure. This is what I know as the requirement. Hope that answers it.
There is one viewer who has also asked me that he is a dental technician. I'm sure it is different than this podcast, but if you can answer it, what is the procedure to work as a technician, a dental technician, if you are a dental technician in India? Is there a separate exam like that for them, or they can directly apply?
Not an issue. I will try to get more information for you about this, but I know just a little bit about this process. Medical lab technicians, dental lab technicians, they have to undergo a course. So about 6 month to 1 year training course. It might differ in different provinces, but because each province has their own legislations on this. But once you have that course, you're basically trained to work as a dental technician. You just need a diploma. And I don't know if there is a direct licensing exam like the one for dentists, unfortunately, but I can definitely try to check more and relay the answer for you. So it is, you have to go through a course at least. That's what I know for sure.
So I think that's it, Dr. Sagar. We had a wonderful podcast, very good conversation. And I'm sure that all these parts, maybe 3 or 4 parts of this podcast would really help all those students or practitioners who want or find difficulty in getting information when they think of going to the Canadian dental board or licensure exam or DDS. It has been really a great pleasure to talk to you on this topic. We started with about PR, the thought process of going to Canada. You shared your experience, your thought process of thinking and going to Canada. You explained about the DDS, how to apply for the dental schools. And now you have explained about the whole exam process in such an amazing way. I really want to thank you for giving your precious time and all this information.
Dr. Shenri, it was my pleasure. It was my honor in being interviewed by you in this podcast. I've had a lot of fun throughout this process. I really enjoyed it. And again, I'd like to thank all of the viewers who made this possible. Thank you so much for your interest. And thank you, Dr. Shenri, for keeping on doing this. You're doing an amazing job at spreading literacy and dental literacy throughout through your channel. I actually follow your channel, so it's really, really informative. Thank you for doing that. And thank you for having me. It was a pleasure being here.
Thank you, Sagar. This all podcasts are actually beneficial because we have such amazing speakers who come to on Aspire 32 and share their experience and knowledge. My dear viewers, I hope this podcast is helpful to you. Please click the like button, mention your questions in the comment section if you have any doubt, and subscribe to the channel. And do share the link with your friends if you think it can be helpful to them. We will come again with many more podcasts very soon on Aspire 32. Bye for now.